My name is Avi Mendelson, and I will cover mainly the architecture and the hardware side of the course, or the acceleration a part of the course. And the first question is why we need to know about hardware, why we care about the architecture. And the answer will be quite simple, because today much of the algorithms, or even the mathematics that we are using, need to take into account the hardware that we are using. And the hardware that we are using depends on the aims, or depends on the environment that we want to support, and we will discuss it later on. So, few words about the history of the computers from our point of view. Again, it's not the history of the computers, but what we care. So actually, this is something that we call the old good days on the computer architecture. And the old good days, actually, that most of the benefit, or most of the algorithms or the improvement came from a process shrink and process technology. And which is very important from the sense that actually you could get next generation performance by using the same software, and assuming that the hardware approximately will look like the one that you have. More than that, you could actually anticipate how the hardware will look next generation in 3 to 5 years. A good example is in the first Windows version, so the mouse almost didn't move, and people actually make a lot of jokes about it. But Bill Gates knew that until the software will be mature enough, the hardware will be mature enough, and then actually the hardware could support the software. And this is part of the reason that Microsoft succeeded, and companies like IBM and so on actually fell, not because the software wasn't good, but because they didn't understood the connection between the hardware and the software. Now, what's happened is that the golden era was over, which means that we cannot scale the frequency anymore, and frequency meaning that we cannot get more performance out of the same architecture, same hardware, and we need to reduce power budget on the top of this, and we're reducing the power usually is done by reducing the frequency, and we lose performance, and there are many other impacts like power density, power delivery, etc. The interesting here is that in order to get better performance, you need to understand the hardware. It is not the case anymore that you can take existing algorithm and just apply it to the new machine. If you try to take a program that you write on a CPU and just run it as is on the GPU, it will not run properly. Even if you make all the compilation and it will run, the performance will be very, very, very bad. So you need to understand not just the software, you need to understand the correlation between the algorithm and even the mathematics that you're using, and the hardware that you are using, and we'll address it later on. A small example, if you are using FPGAs, it's something that we'll discuss in a few minutes. FPGAs has a very few number of floating points, which means that practically talking, you cannot use floating point anymore. But all the algorithms that we will refer to them, at least in the beginning, are using floating point. So you need to change even the mathematics that you are using in order to be able to get good performance on the new platform. So the first question will be, okay, so why to use FPGAs? And the answer is because it is more power efficient, and many times it is more cost efficient, etc. So there are good economical reasons for using it. The second question is, assuming that you want to use it, so now you cannot just take the existing algorithm and just apply them, which is great for research, because every year you can research the same thing that you did before and just adjust it to a new architecture. No, it's not the only reason, but actually many people are dealing with the combination between hardware and software these days. Okay, so the solution is to do things in parallel, or to go to parallel, and I will not go into all the details because many of you don't have the electrical background, but in general, we need to understand that we are limited by the power, and power is proportional to the frequency, data frequency in the power of 2.5. Which means that each time that you increase the frequency, for example, I want to get to double the performance, I will double the frequency in order to get double the performance. It means that I'm getting 8 times, or actually 7 times, or 6.5 times the power that I need. So if the power fixed, so you cannot increase the frequency, you need to do something else. And to do something else is to do things in parallel. You do things in parallel, usually the performance that you are the part that you need to pay is only linear, which is much better, and then actually you can get much more performance for the same amount of power, and this is something that even if we are not fully understanding it, this is something which is very, very important. The most of the solutions is to do things in parallel. And this is what most of the accelerators try to achieve. And when you go to parallel, it changes many of the things that we are doing. So all of you that actually took the courses in computer architecture will find out that when we are talking about accelerators, almost everything that we teach you in the past is not true anymore. Yeah. This is what we call to go to parallel.
But why don't you see it already?
Oh, you are seeing it. You're seeing it, and I'll address it in a few minutes. I'll show you that actually you don't know that you are doing it, but this is exactly what we are doing. If you just take in, I'll talk about it in a few minutes, about GPUs, for example. GPUs are using very simple cores instead of very complicated one, but using many of them. Okay, so the conclusion is that as long as enough parallelism exists, you want to do things in parallel. So, please note, you need to have a parallelism, because if you just take a regular program that doesn't have parallelism, it will not help you anymore. But if you have parallelism, so you can do it much more efficiently if you're doing it parallel. So part of the algorithms that we are developing recently is to take something that looks like sequential and try to parallelize it. Or even look at the same problem and try to think, how can I do something similar or get similar results, but in parallel processing, because it gives you a lot of performance relatively to what you can achieve in a single processor. So, this is the very, very basic a principle. And then we see that there are different type of parallel systems. We call multi-core usually if you have a traditional Intel architecture and you put 2, 4, 6 cores inside. We call it many cores when we take a 512 or 1,000 or etc. cores, and all of them are very tiny. We address it later on. We call it many cores and heterogeneity if we just mix it. And this is actually the model that we are using in accelerators. We are using both of them. So, let's talk a little bit about CPUs and GPUs. So CPUs is what we are familiar with usually. So we have few number of CPUs, and we have a lot of memory. We have caches, and we have DRAMs, and we have registers, etc. The main reason for putting all this logic, to put all this memory, is to reduce the latency. So this is what we have in mind, because we don't have enough parallelism in the system, so we want to accelerate what we have, and we can accelerate it mainly if we reduce the average access to the memory. What we are doing when we are talking about GPUs? GPUs, see, the green is the logic. So in GPUs, what we are doing is we are running it in much lower frequency, but we have many, many, many of very small logic, very small CPUs, very simple CPUs. And later on, we'll talk about all the different ways to get around memory latencies and so on. This is not, we will not do it today. Maybe when we'll talk about how to program GPUs. But the main idea, doing exactly what you said before, put something like thousands of cores, small cores, and in NVIDIA, the modern one, you have a few thousands of small cores. Put them together, run them relatively in a small frequency, and actually don't care so much about the memory. By the way, it is not true anymore, and we'll discuss it later on. But again, the motivation here is that they started from graphics. This is the reason that these are graphic cards. They started from the point of view that in graphics you have almost infinite number of parallelism, amount of parallelism. Why? Because you can view each pixel in the screen as an independent pixel that I need to calculate it. So if you don't have enough parallelism, just move to high definition or super high definition, and you have enough parallelism in the system. Yeah. Okay, so 1 minute I'll reach it. So in general, you put a lot of small cores, but, and this is what we call excellent question, because I need to address it anyhow. There are some functions that you need that you need to implement them, and not by just software, but by what we call special functionalities. And these are either functions that deal with a special format of the graphics, because it still needs to run graphics. So, for example, they have special logic for what they call texture, and they have special formats, etc., special calculation. Or they have special functionality like a double precision or a MAC, which is multiple add, etc. And for this special functionality, so they put some special hardware inside. Later on, we'll see that in the recent version, they also put special functionality for machine learning. Yeah, the green are the general purpose that actually run programs in a very unique way. It's not in a simple way, but in a very unique way. The brown and the orange are special functionality. Some of them is for memory, some of them are for functions. Another thing which is very important is that they don't need a lot of memory, but the memory that they can use, because the access time is relatively slow, so they can actually treat memory and register almost in the same way, which gives them some flexibility, but again, we'll address it later on, not now. So, again, why we care about machine learning in that perspective? And the answer is that, first of all, in machine learning, there is a lot of parallelism. And when we look at the mathematics of machine learning, we'll find out that most of the time we are doing linear algebra. Linear algebra with a lot of, with a very large matrices and so on. And anything that can accelerate linear algebra is good for machine learning. So this is one very important aspect why people are using accelerator in general and GPUs in particular. But then came this graph that actually showed that we may have a second look at the all the problem. By the way, this graph was produced by people from NVIDIA, and it is mainly used to show that the NVIDIA solution is not sufficient and not good enough anymore. This graph actually shows how much energy you are using for each operation. And surprisingly enough, the amount of we can have some conclusions. First of all, even if you have 8-bit adds, it is the loss. And then to do add is relatively low power. But if you move to floating point, so floating point consumes more power, but not a lot more. Which means that if you look, for example, how much it takes you to read 32 bytes of DRAM, so it is not comparable to the amount of power that you need in order to do the mathematics. Which means that the fact that in today's GPUs, you have a very small amount of memory in the on die memory. And you need all the time to transfer data between register and to the memory and to the DRAM, etc., consumes a lot of power, even more than what they save by putting a lot of small devices to do the computation. Something else is that traditionally, GPUs used to make all the computation either by what they call single floating point or double, which were 32-bit floating point or 64-bit floating point. Now the amount of power that you consume when you go to 8-bit or 16-bit is much less than the power that you need in order to do the 32-bit, and we don't have the 64 here. More than that, to do the operation in integer is almost order of magnitude less than to do the same operations in floating point. Which means that all the trade-offs that we are taking when we design algorithms start to change when you realize that first of all, communication costs you a lot of power, so you need to be very sensitive to communication. Secondly, that floating point is much more power consumption than integer, and the amount of bits that you are using for the computation is very, very important as well. So in the we'll see it in the new generations of GPUs, they start to have support for lower precision for floating point and integer, they increase the amount of buffers and the amount of memory, and it starts to look more like general purpose, and this is on one hand. On the other hand, we start seeing special purpose architectures that were really tailored for machine learning applications. We'll extend it in a minute. Questions? So this is just to give you a very high level overview of the amount of parallel computations that we are using today. The most common operation that people are using is the multiple N accumulate, which is multiple and add, and we can see that if in the very in the past we need only around 350k operations, today we are talking about a 15.5 gig operation or 3.9 gig operations. But more than that, if we look on amount of weights or amount of data that we need to store and to move around, so in the past it was 60K, and today we are talking about 25.5 meg. And we can see that the trade-offs are changing all the time. And again, what is the best algorithm for your purposes is very, very depend on what you try to achieve. And if you are talking about the learning or the inference, or if you are talking about car, or you are talking about doing some smart search in the cloud. Both of them are using the same acronym of AI. Many times both of them are using CNNs and so on, but the way that you implement it is very, very different, depend on the purpose, depending on the budget that you have, budget in terms of money and power, etc., and in terms of how fast you want to get the results, and of course accuracy. By the way, in engineering, unlike in science, we never have one answer, which is what is the right solution. Everything is up to trade-offs. And this is something that we need to understand. If you want to get something in real time, you need to give up some accuracy. If you want to get high accuracy, you pay with something. There is no universal algorithm that solves everything. Okay, so who works on hardware accelerators? Almost everybody. And this is amazing, almost everybody, because all the big companies are trying to produce chips for AI. Again, in for the different markets, etc. So, I just enumerate some of them. In this course, by the way, we mainly focus on the use of GPUs, and maybe we have something about FPGAs, but the main focus will be on using GPUs through the PyTorch interface. So you'll see that the environment today allows you quite easy to go from general something that run on a general purpose computer to something that will run on accelerator, and it will be done by the environment. Again, if you want to do something which is optimized, then you need to understand how your accelerator is built. But in order just to get 3x, 5x, maybe even 10x, it is relatively easy. In order to get accelerator of 100x, you need to be expert. The main difference is in your salary is about order of magnitude in the salary, so you need to consider if it was to study it or not. But this is not scientific, this is the reality. Okay, so few observations about a few chips that were built. So Intel, in the past, they claimed that their Intel Knights Landing is perfect for machine learning. The reason, what they call a Xeon Phi, etc. The reason was that they used to have something like 42 processors later on, 72 processors on die, and they claimed that this is perfect for machine learning applications. It wasn't a great success, and just as an evidence, Intel recently stopped to produce them, and they are looking for other solutions. But again, this was an interesting direction. There are rumors, and maybe even more than rumors, that Intel will put in their regular instruction set. They will extend it, like today they have vector operations, and in the near future they will have operation that will do convolutions, part of the convolution, or matrix multiplication, and we have a very efficient support as part of the regular processor they have, and we'll address it, and we'll see what NVIDIA is doing, and I assume that it is something very similar. By the way, I spoke with people from ARM, and they are doing the same, so it is not just Intel. All the big companies are looking to the solution that will give them some acceleration to the regular processor, assuming that from the software point of view, people will prefer maybe to get a little bit less performance and a little bit more power, but to have some environment that they know how to program and relatively easy to maintenance, etc. So this is the trend that the big companies are taking. GPUs. So GPUs, actually, the NVIDIA Pascal was intended to be targeted machine learning, and that time the main support that they had was to introduce the NVLink, and the NVLink is a bus which is about 8 times faster than the PCI Express, and they assume that the part of the difficulty in machine learning is the data transfer, so this was the support. But recently they introduced the Volta, and the Volta has something which is unique. I think that this is just a minute. No. Sorry, how I go back. Okay. The Volta itself has a special unit, and again, in later classes, maybe we'll address it. There's a special unit that this unit can know how to take 4x4 matrix to multiply it by 4x4 matrix. And both of them are 32 bits operations. Add to it another matrix, which can be either 32 or 16 bits, and to get the result, all of it on average, again, they are not doing it every cycle, but on average, they can complete such operation in a pipeline every cycle. So this is a very important basic block for many, many, many linear algebra operations. So they just implement it as part of the architecture, and they are doing it in a very, very efficient way. So there are still around 300 watt power, which means that I don't believe that you want to put them in your cellular phone. At least I don't. And so this is very, very high-end device, but most likely in the future they will have something similar with reduced power for mobile application. And mainly today, all of the companies are focusing on automotive and this kind automatic cars and automotive cars, etc. This is a very important target. So I try to go quite fast. Another trend is to go to FPGA. FPGA is something which is it's called field array programmable logic. And the idea here is that you can look at it as an array, huge array of logic, that you can combine it by yourself for larger and larger units. So you are programming it in order to implement your own ALUs and your own devices, etc. The big advantage, and you have a lot of communication passes inside. I don't go into all the details, but the idea is that you can, in FPGA, you can actually build your own ALU that will be 4-bit or 6-bit or 8-bit or you name it, because you have the basic component that you can build out of it, something which is very, very efficient in terms both of power and in terms of communication. Usually they have what they call DSPs, which is a floating point. units, but and you have on-chip memory that the memory itself can be used either for the logic as the in order to implement logic or as a memory, etc. So we have Intel that bought Altera, and we have Xilinx. They are the most common companies, but we start seeing that companies like Alibaba, for example, the Chinese company, they bought some another Chinese company that they produce their own FPGAs, and we start seeing that many companies try to build either their own FPGAs or ASIC, that ASIC is just a kind of implementation of a specific implementation of the FPGA in a very, very efficient way, because we remove all the programmability, and when you remove the programmability, you can implement it in a more efficient way on die. So it is clear that if you have some logic that you want to implement, for example, you have a civilian camera that you want to detect faces and so on, there is an algorithm that you want to implement it, so you will produce your own ASIC for this if you want it to be done in a least power consumption. But if you have something that you want to change the algorithm, for example, Microsoft put as part of the Azure clouds about actually power around the Bing search machine, they put a huge FPGA farm of FPGAs that they are doing all the queries and try to understand voice, etc. So this is something which is highly programmable. So for this one, they are using a very, very powerful FPGAs. All of them are using similar technologies, again with the different scales. So another breakthrough is the Google Tensor, and right now we have TPU1 and TPU2, but the name of Tensor is just rename of vectors. Usually in machine learning, for some reason, when they use vectors, they call it tensors. But the Google TPU, which is the Tensor Processing Unit, is something which is very, very interesting, because they actually built here a very, very sophisticated machine to do linear algebra operations. So you say, wow, this is something which is really, really neat and cool. And the answer is yes, but the technology was invented on the mid-18s. That time it was called systolic arrays. So you can see that many times, instead of going forward, we are taking architecture and algorithms that used to be efficient in the past, then because of many reasons people forgot about them, and now we are using them again. So in general, the main idea of this tensor, that on one hand it is programmable, but for very restricted operations, so it has something like between 10 to 20, I can't remember exactly, instruction set. But this instruction set, they can do it in a very, very, in a very, very efficient way. And the basic algorithm, which is the mathematical unit, so actually they can take a matrix that they actually put them like in a data flow. They just put the instruction in that direction. From the other direction came the other matrix, and then the operation go out of the other two corners of this shape. It works again. It was invented many years ago, but they are using it in a very sophisticated way. They also can do operation like 8-bit integer operations, quite efficient there. And later on in toward the end of the course, I will go back and I will discuss algorithms that which are good to this kind of architecture. Again, we'll see that they have some limitation that other architectures try to avoid. But in general, this is a very interesting approach to have a very efficient implementation of machine learning. And this is the reason that many, many people are moving their algorithms to this architecture. Yeah. Very good, very excellent point. And this is something which is very fundamental in the area of machine learning. Machine learning never guarantee you to get the same results. Machine learning in general works on the principle that you want to get some results with some probability. So unlike regular mathematics, or what we call discrete mathematics, that we know that 1 plus 1 is something close to 2 for most of us, in machine learning you give a picture and the classifier will tell you with 90% this is a cat, but there are 10% that this is a dog. And of course, you assume, okay, 90% versus 10%, so most likely this is a cat. But the notion is usually, and in big data in general, usually the notion is that you are getting approximation of things. So one of the measurements that we are taking is that for a given accuracy of the algorithm, so you want to get power performance whatsoever. Or the opposite. Many times you say, okay, I will to give up the accuracy, but I want to do it in low power, etc. But all the models assume that you don't need an accurate result. When we go later on to things like binarization, quantization, which are a form of using either binary operations or integer operation to replace the floating point, is not that that we are saying that a floating point is not needed. We just saying that the accuracy that we can get by using integer is good enough for us, so we don't need to use the floating point. So again, the idea, and this is the reason that we can change things, because this is a kind of engineering, that we know that we are losing accuracy, we know that there are limitations, but we say, okay, but this is good enough. This is part of the problem that we have in all this field of machine learning, that if you ask even the best expert in the world, many times the answer is trial and error. We just check it and it works. And it goes both ways. I can use it, for example, to use what we call approximate computing, which means that intentionally I'm using execution units like ALU, which is way, way below the frequency which is allowed in order to get reliable a result. But say, I don't care, so the results are not reliable. Nothing bad happened. On average, I will get the good results. This is something that usually you don't like to do it when you control your airplane. For many of the machine learning algorithm, this is good enough. And this is a big battle, even how I debug my algorithms, because I get a result, it's correct, incorrect, and there is an entire science which we will call adversary attack, which is how to cheat the algorithm, assuming that the algorithm is correct. I can cheat the algorithm and get and make the algorithm to predict wrong results. Yeah, these are things that we will discuss later on during the class, and we are almost at the end, so I'll try to go very fast. So one last slide that I want to mention, that since we said that memory access is very, very important, one of the things that we'll see that happening is that we try to actually to use what we call memory over logic, that we try to pack them together so the latency or the length of the lines between the memory and the CPU will reduce, and then will save a power. So again, when you design your algorithm, you need to understand what are the target, but also you need to understand the architecture in turn. Do I need to optimize for memory? Do I need to optimize for communication? Do I need to optimize for less operations? Each one of them will lead you to a different solution, to a different algorithm. So this is the reason that we actually put together these schools that try to combine the algorithm side and the architecture side, because we believe that in order to understand the area, you need to understand both sides, and to understand one side is not good enough. Questions? Okay, thank you.